Hello, folks. I'd like to talk to you all today, while we're out here, about this thing called the wild within. I've noticed that a lot of people like to define themselves according to, let's say, politically or spiritually correct definitions. This flatters them and enables them to project a nice image of themselves, to promote themselves, let's say. I think the term wild within is much better than Ramana's term of existence, consciousness, bliss, because it implies something that's not correct, but yet something that is. Now, how do we even get around starting to find something like the wild within? It has to do with our sense of I. We have to follow that sense of I down until we find where it really lives, rather than where we've been taught and like to think it is. Let's give examples. Say, I hiked up the hill. I'm filming a video. I like tea. If you follow that sense of I, especially when it comes out in a spontaneous moment, you'll see it arises up out of the center of the heart, let's say, rises up, comes out through the brain and the vocal cords. If you follow this sense of I down, you'll see that it's come to find a home in an illusion, the illusion of the individual self. The I is actually that wild, undefined part of us, which is everything, which exists, which is alive in a true sense, which has no characteristics. You might call it the causal dimension. The term wild within I like, and I first heard it from Paul Resendez, a wildlife tracker who had similar path to mine, and that he spent a lot of his time on the spiritual path out of doors looking at the things in nature. He noticed that animals don't have their sense of I and an ego and a flattering sense of themselves which is correct and which they can promote and bend it around to fit whatever political mode is in fashion at the time to make good YouTube videos. But it's that which in them is spontaneous, which doesn't think. It's pre-verbal. It's wild. And it is within. If you make a practice of following the sense of I down into the heart, and do this, say, on solitary retreats when the social self isn't present. The social self is about the least real part of us. So if we can get out in the woods for a while, somewhere where the social self can die out, and feel where that sense of I comes from, it's coming from that wild part of us, the spontaneous part. This is the part which is there even when we're in deep sleep, when we're unconscious, when we pass out. It's still there, and you can find it. Just follow that sense of I. Track yourself. Paul calls this inner tracking. I used to call it stalking the self. If you can follow that sense of I, past all the illusions, all the social parts, all the politically correct parts, past the fears, the desires, down into what is alive in you. What is the part in you that exists before life and after death, which is primary to the mind? This is the wild within. This is the part that is real. This is where our sense of I comes from and where it lives. But we've misplaced it. We've put it out into the ego, in the mind, in the least real part of ourselves. You can find this whenever something traumatic happens to you. The sense of I gets knocked right out the window from the ego and ends up back in the real quiet part of yourself. If you've been knocked out, traumatized in a way, you can see this. You don't have to go that route. You can't plan that anyway, but follow that sense of I. Find where it leads. It'll come down into that calm, clear part of yourself that's real. The part that's there no matter what's going on, what voice you have that's using your mouth, no matter where your ego flies, what the mind is engrossed in, the part of you that's there when you're asleep, when you're awake, and in between. Find the wild within. This takes one strange thing that seems to be missing nowadays in a lot of spiritual work, and that's the ability to be honest with yourself. Track yourself. Stalk that elusive eye. Then you'll find out what real freedom means.